Hi, I welcome you to this edition of Strategy Lemon's channel, which is dedicated to diversification as practiced in Indian businesses. Now, the idea of this channel is to see that the management of business practices are driven not by science of management, but more by past practices. And there is a wide gap between management theory and practice. We bring and we'll discuss Cafe Coffee Day, which was recently in the news because of its CEO ending his life on July 30th, 2019, for reasons related to his business. Now, the idea of this channel is to promote business practices that strengthen enterprises and prevent erosion of value. And we wish to discuss replacing strategy with what's called strategy lemons. Now, the way we go about this session is that first of all, we identify the issues related to Cafe Coffee Day, which led to Mr. Siddhartha ending his life in July 2019. Then we identify the management theory related to firm scope, and then follow up with the discussion of what we learned from this. The Cafe Coffee Day story, as it starts, is Mr. Siddhartha left a note after his demise, and that note suggested that he had taken a loan from private equity partners about 6 months back, and he could not develop a profitable business model for Cafe Coffee Day. So those were the two reasons that he identified as the motivation for him to which distressed him so much that he ended his life. Now, we discussed the first issue of private equity finance. Now, he had incurred a debt 6 months earlier from private equity investment company, and during this period between December 2018 and July 30th, he had sold his shares in one of the companies he held, and there was a cash inflow of 3200 crore rupees, but apparently this was not enough to retire his debts. The other issue is that he had identified that he could not build a profitable business model in Cafe Coffee Day. Now, CCD had issued an IPO in October 2015 for 1,150 crore rupees at a share value of nearly 317 to 328 per share of face value of rupees 10. The amount of 1,150 crore rupees was proposed to be utilized as that 625 crore rupees on refinancing the debt, rupees 88 crore on setting up new cafes and Coffee Day Express kiosk, and 104 crore rupees on refurbishment of existing cafes and on setting up a new coffee roasting facility. Now, his business, Cafe Coffee Day's business, was that included technology parks, logistics, financial services, and hospitality services, apart from the software firm Mindtree and Seacal Logistics. All of these had been partly or fully owned by Mr. Siddhartha along with CCDE. Now, according to the news reports, during the period when the public issue came in 2015 October, that Cafe Coffee Day had been relying on a very high rate of growth, opening 176 stores during the past year, and in these stores were opened in very high lease rental areas. The issue opened in stock market on November 2, 2015, and immediately on the opening day, share price fell from 317 to 276. and it has traded in the same range since November 2015 till July 2019, except for a very brief period in January 2018 when it touched 376 rupees. But that was for a very brief period. Mostly it has traded between 200 or even below 200 to 276. During the same period from November 2015 to now, July 2019, Nifty rose from 8,000 to 11,000. Now, what are the reasons of such poor stock market performance of CCDE? Was the stock market frowning on wide range of businesses that Mr. Siddhartha was managing, or so-called diversification, or was the stock market frowning on the business model, which was relied on very high growth and in a very high lease rental areas? According to a case study published by Harvard, CCDE was competing with Starbucks. The outlets that CCDE was opening, and it had owned nearly around 1,600 outlets, and Mr. Siddhartha was quoted as saying that giving same level of service in all the outlets was increasingly very difficult. The next issue that he identified was that whereas the customer was spending around 450 to 600 rupees in Starbucks, as compared to about 175 rupees only in CCD. So these were the two main reasons why Mr. Siddhartha for competition from Starbucks. Now, if you look at the schematic diagram of Cafe Coffee Day versus Starbucks and look at the customer segments, the Starbucks is operating in around 10 to 15% of the market, whereas Cafe Coffee Day was serving nearly 40% of the market. Both had different customer segments. Starbucks serve high value end customers and Cafe Coffee Day serve typically the youth segment. Now, what is the strategy lemon here? The diversification is supposed to be rewarding for companies, and companies indulge into diversification chiefly for taking advantage of opportunities opening before them, that is, invest surplus money in new products and geographies, and they adopt diversification as lowering the overall business risk. And the third is that they feel that the new business opportunity is too attractive. Now, there are several issues with any of these assumptions, and that we'll come back to later. But this must be noted that any issue when a business diversifies, it tends to overstretch either the existing resources, which could include the CEO's bandwidth, or some other resources which the company feels that they may have excess capacity in. So those are some of the fundamental assumptions under which diversifications are undertaken. So what is this strategy theory? In developed markets, diversification versus performance is an inverted U-shaped curve. A U-shape means when you plot diversification on vertical axis, Y-axis, and performance on X, the performance nearly falls. There is a huge study by Hoskinson and Hitt covering all the research that is covered until 1990. The underlying theory of diversification is given by, and she has suggested that managers tend to diversify when they feel there is an excess capacity available in existing resources with the company. Now, this needs to be very carefully understood before diversification can become rewarding. What is the theory for emerging markets like India? Now, why diversification in the Indian market has been founded on the basis of some imperfect market situations as postulated by Khemaut and Khanna, Khanna and Rifkin, Khanna and Palepu, so on between 1995 and 2000. You know, paper that we cite here, and that is Khanna and Palepu, which is published in Journal of Finance, and they cited that there are various kind of market failures in India. Financial markets are characterized by absence and inadequacy of involvement of financial analysts, mutual fund investment banker, venture capitalists, and financial press. What this means is that any and all of these intermediaries are not paying as much attention as they should be paying in disseminating the information about opportunities, investment opportunities to the public, and therefore and then there is no recourse back to the advice given by any of these intermediaries, and therefore the financial markets remain imperfect. The product market failures were characterized by limited enforcement of liability laws, little information dissemination, and no activist consumers, which means that if you are handed a bad product or a product with which you may have certain complaints, there is little recourse available to this. And therefore, it's probably rewarding for the companies to come out with imperfect products and still make money. So when the systems are broken, then it makes it promotes or it incentivizes the companies to diversify widely. Then these are backed up by government regulation, which is excessive, corruption is rampant, the enforcement mechanism is unpredictable. In all, we're talking about a broken system promoting wide diversification. An alternate theory suggested by Ronald Coase, the Nobel laureate, who was awarded Nobel Prize in 1991. Based on his theory of the firm, which he said that the firm scope depends on high market transaction costs. If the market transaction costs are high, then the firms will expand. But if the markets are efficient, if a transaction can be carried out in the market, then the firm size should shrink. Now, market development over a period of time leads to lower transaction costs, and if that happens, then the firm should contract in scope as markets become more efficient. Now, one needs to realize that Indian market was opened in number of sectors. The glasnost of Indian economy started happening in 1991, and it continues to this day. That's market reforms are being slowly and surely being introduced by each successive government, strengthening intermediaries, opening up new sectors to foreign competition, and so on and so forth. What we see, what happened during this period, and those made tremendous changes on transaction costs, was that there's a national stock exchange came into being. Then telecom revolution happened post 1995. And then Google also happened. All these three, in a way, brought about a transformational change in bringing down the transaction cost. So people could search information, could easily find a supplier, and enter into a contract, and consummate a deal. Which because there was no Google, it was very difficult to find information of where the suppliers are. Likewise, National Stock Exchange introduced transparent trading. Which means that it was possible to see at what rate was a particular stock bought and sold, and this replaced the paper-based trading in which a broker wrote the contract and and a buyer or seller had no way of confirming at what rate the stock was bought or sold, except that the broker would say whatever he would say is truth, is the truth. Now he could see, the buyer or the seller could see. So this is what happened, and communication brought down the cost of talking to people and so on and so forth. So all in all these three developments resulted in bringing down the transaction cost tremendously. What we are suggesting here is that the markets became more efficient in a number of ways. Now, the companies which had diversified on the basis of inefficient markets needed to restructure. As far as Cafe Coffee Day is concerned, what we see here is that Starbucks entered India in 2012 in alliance with Tata Group. Now, as a result of bringing down of transaction costs, some firms restructured or pared down the excessive fat. They did so proactively. Tata Group immediately entered into divesting of non-core businesses. Like, for an example, they sold off Tomco. The other firms who had similarly diversified into number of verticals, they learned their lessons the hard way. And we could see that some of the companies like ICICI, Future Group, Reliance, had to bring down their number of verticals from the earlier launches to quite a substantial reduced size. So this is what is called a phase of perestroika. Now we come back to Cafe Coffee Day. So how did it respond to competition in 2015? It had invested money that it raised from public issues. Before the public issue, it had upgraded 150 stores. It had focused on innovating its food and beverage offerings, and it slightly raised its prices from 66 rupees for a small cup of cappuccino to 79 rupees, whereas Starbucks was charging 120 rupees for the same. Now, average daily sales in Cafe Coffee Day outlet on an average basis was about 18,000 rupees, which had risen from 14,400 in 2013. Whereas the Starbucks in 2015, average per day sales were nearly 72,000 to about 84,000. This is based on the case study published by Howard. Now here are the questions. Cafe Coffee Day had the youth segment. And Starbucks had a different segment at the higher end of the market. Now the question is, and Cafe Coffee Day was trying to compete in the other segment maintained by Starbucks. So the question here is that should Cafe Coffee Day compete in these two customer segments, including which included the niche created by Starbucks? Now, to find the answers to this, one must remember what happened in a similar situation to Kingfisher Airlines when it started serving two customer segments with Kingfisher Premium and Kingfisher Red. Our next question is that what is the right customer segment for CCD? And the third question that we ask here is this, that if cash flow from operations was not enough to fund upgradation of stores, where should the money have come from? Stock markets, unrelated businesses? Now we posed this question because there was already an introduction of National Stock Exchange, which brought up a lot of transparency and demanded a lot of information from promoters, and therefore this issue becomes important. Now we come back to the two customer segments which we talked about earlier. And you said that there is one in the red shown to be the customer segment occupied by Cafe Coffee Day, and the other segment in green was marginally belonging to Starbucks. Now the question here is that should CCD have competed in these two segments? We say, how would we answer this question? So one way to look at it is that you look at historical net profit per square feet, because retail is finally a game of how much do you earn or sell per square feet of space. The second segment in which the CCD was trying to put some footprint was the space occupied in a space in green, which is occupied by Starbucks. So what is the net profit margin per square feet? And we're talking about marginal net profit for additional square feet which was launched in this space. Now when we talk about additional or marginal net profit margin, was it greater than weighted average cost of capital? And that would, if that was true, then only it would make sense to enter the green space, or else leave this green space for Starbucks and remain in a historical customer segment as occupied by CCDE. So answers seem pretty obvious. Why is it that the firms or Indian businesses find it hard to adopt what is there in the theory? And how do we bridge this gap between management science theory and business practice? Now, it's always when you are in a board, then there's pretty little you can do in that board except to go with the flow, even if you were made the captain. And there's a certain way of doing things that the organizations do, and that has been driven by past beliefs. Now those past beliefs were developed because of the organization history in a very, very different organizational environment. Now that organizational environment drove the kind of practices that the organizations adopted. Now, since all of those what we call as pestle factors, as political, economic, social, technological, all those factors have undergone a tremendous change, does it make sense to continue with those practices? Now, so one may realize that yes, probably it doesn't make sense to adopt those practices which were developed during the Ramayana or Mahabharata time to current environment, which is fast changing VUCA environment. But still the organization continued to adopt the same practices. So the question that we ask is, does it need a born again Vasco da Gama to change organization's way of doing things, and that they don't pick up strategy lemons? With this thoughts, we leave you, and you're welcome to share this video, share your thoughts, connect with us on www.3cubestrategy.com. Or you can write to us for if you have any questions on 3cubestrategy@gmail.com, or you can phone us at +91 831 968 1167. Have a good day. Thank you.